There's this saying that if you continue doing the same thing the same way and expecting a different result, that's what's another definition of madness. Now, you talked about how over time, with the different heads of that department or ministry, we've had the same situation and doesn't seem to be changing. Are we looking at alternatives?
Let me also agree with you and say this. Actually, today is a different thing. Before, it was a monolithic enterprise in which you had both distribution, generation, transmission, and all that in one entity. And at that point, government was carrying all the burdens and everything. And part of the solution, which you're now talking about, is breaking it up into these disparate units, for which generation is private, transmission is government, and distribution is private. They copied a model, I think a model from India, although somebody recently told us that it was a model of Lesotho. But the point really is this. There was a shift away from the monolithic model so that there could be more efficiencies. The real problem we're having today is why those efficiencies that were envisaged not coming up at. And for the average consumer, the efficiency is, let me have power.
That's all there.
That's all that there is
so
to it.
So you move from a monolithic structure to a broken down structure. Yeah, so maybe what I would have said, okay, from Professor Barton Nadi to your date, you're still doing the same thing, and we've not had any significant difference. I mean, significant here, I mean, to the consumer himself.
Yeah, for the consumer, so you've not really had
any significant. Can we move? What about captured power? What other alternatives are we looking at?
Well, the alternative that you see today is off-grid power, where you do solar and so forth. But to run a modern economy like we want to run an industrial economy like we can't bypass having the proper structures laid out.
Senator, there's a big role that the National Assembly needs to play here. There's several people who keep asking the questions about the laws, what the laws allow states to do in terms of generating their own power. And then the big question is, must we continue to have the national grid?
No, we don't have to. I think there's another way. The other way is to let states that are capable also do their own. But you know, you have to amend the laws. Some states have built power stations. I think Rivers State, Akwa Ibom, Lagos at one time too. But the law at that time made it difficult for them to put it on the grid that is national to cover just their own areas. And so it is those amendments that were done when the privatization process was done. But today, the transmission network is still federal government owned. That means that if you build a power plant today, you will have to get into a power
purchase agreement,
a sale agreement or a purchase agreement with the federal government, represented by Bulk Electricity Trading Company, and in order to get the power into the grid. So there are solutions, and those are part of the reasons why we had the summit.
So, what does the law make any impact if the government should hands off completely from power distribution?
I wanted to find out, what exactly does the law say about the state? How much can they generate to go to the national grid, and how much do they generate that doesn't need to get to the national grid?
Well, there's a minimum. I don't have it offhand, but I do not think that there's any level where you can say you can't go beyond this level. You can generate as much as you can, so long as you able to have the capacity to do so. So I don't think anything stops states from getting into it. But you see, power, it's a very, very costly business. It's not just something that you wake up and go into.
So do you support that government should hands off? the whole chain.
We think also that strategically, it will not be good for government to pull back from it. The reason is that for reasons of defense, for reasons of our national integrity. If you hands off fully without being sure of how you can use the law and make people obey the law, you may just run into problems.
Someone will give you an example of telephony, how the government backed up telephony and instead set up a regulator who's monitoring what's going on there. And they'll tell you that, why can't we go that way?
No, but that's how it is today. The National Electricity Regulatory Commission is there as a regulator.
But the government is still in transmission.
Yeah, government is still in transmission because of the strategic nature of transmission. They should be able to go off all of them sometime down the line. I think government just continue to carry part of this burden.
Let me take you back to the laws. When Chamberlain talked about the laws we have as regards power.
Yes.
The amount that each state can generate for itself. I know it's stated, although you said you don't have it offhand, but is it not possible to allow the states to generate power for their residents, for the residents of each state, so that what's on the grid, on the national grid, can be used for the industrialization of this country in different parts of the country? Is it not possible?
Yes, it's possible, but then that means that the state will first have to take a census of its own area. And you know that today the distribution of companies supersedes or crosses beyond one state. So for one state to ring fence itself will mean that that state will have to go into maybe an agreement with the distribution company to say, hey, when we put our generation into the grid and it comes back here, this is what we're... I think there's some ring fencing going on. There was a ring fencing in Aba, which eventually became a subject of litigation with Batanaji's geometric power and so forth. So it's not like it's not a concept that has not been thought about. But I think it is the fact of the way the whole thing is today that may make that a little bit difficult.
Are you able to control... Another concern, of course. Are you able to control the increase in tariff as senators, considering the government has said that tariffs should be halted?
Well, I think the question of the government saying tariffs, I remember that the minister made that statement, but we felt that it wasn't very proper. The reason is this. The question of tariffs is supposed to be settled by the Electricity Regulatory Commission, working in conjunction with every stakeholder within the system, because there are variables that you use to determine the appropriate tariff. And you know, tariffs are different from area to area, from disco to disco. So the question of the National Assembly is that at the point at which they are getting all those variables and trying to get to the appropriate tariff, of course, they brief the National Assembly, and we also take into consideration being those that represent the people. We don't want a tariff that will be, you know, too burdensome on Nigerians. We won't also want a tariff that will be so low that it will not be sustainable, you know, going forward. And so you must have to come to a sort of balance. And that's why I said at the beginning that there is this gap always there. That's when you hear about the liquidity crisis in power, it is the gap between the tariff and the cost of power. Let's just put it that way. In certain other areas, decisions are made by government to say, this is how we will intervene in making sure that this liquidity crisis does not continue to increase. We have also, in the course of that summit, looked at this issue, and it is part of the recommendations we are going to make to government to say you must have to come in
And this is what we suggest should be the way that you come in.